Okay, hello. Welcome back. My name is Ricardo Montoya, and we will continue checking time tenses, okay? As you remember, on the last few classes, we were checking the simple present, the simple past, the simple future, the present continuous, the past continuous, the future continuous, or progressive. And we check how to use them, when to use them, and what is the difference between them. I think, as you remember, maybe the simple present and the simple past are the two most difficult ones. If you have any questions about them, I recommend, again, going back and check them first. Today, we're going to be speaking about the present perfect. We're gonna move on to a new time tense, okay? We were checking the simple time tenses, also the continuous time tenses, and right now, we're going to move on to the perfect time tenses. So, first, the present perfect, when do you use it? What is the meaning of that? When do you use the present perfect? Okay. The present perfect is used to speak about unfinished actions. So, I don't know if you remember, but when we were speaking about the simple past, in the simple past, we were speaking about finished actions, something that is over. When you say, I didn't do my homework, it means I didn't do my homework, and that's it. You cannot change it. I didn't do my homework, and that's finished, and that's it. If you say, I haven't finished my homework, or I haven't done my homework, it means up until this point, in this moment, I haven't done my homework. It's not an experience that I have had, but I still have a chance. Maybe the homework is for tomorrow or due to next week, okay? So maybe I still have time. The fact that I haven't done my homework doesn't mean that I won't, yeah? It's an unfinished action. The simple past is finished actions. The present perfect, the present perfect is unfinished actions. Also, you use the present perfect to speak about experiences. For example, you can say something like, I have eaten sushi. When you say, I have eaten sushi, well, it's something that you have done. You're not saying how many times you have done it. You're not speaking about maybe you have done it 2 times, 3 times, 10 times, 100 times, maybe just once. But if you say, I have eaten sushi, it means that in your life you have had the experience. Or you can be also speaking about things that you did in the past, but it doesn't matter when or how many times. Again, I have gone to Spain. Maybe if you say, I have gone to Spain, it doesn't mean when. Maybe it was yesterday, or maybe it was 3 weeks ago, or maybe it was 25 years ago. Maybe you have gone to Spain 1 time, or maybe 3 times, or maybe 1,000 times. It doesn't really matter. When you say, I have done something, it's an experience that you have had, and it's not important when you did it or how many times you did it. With a simple past, you're speaking about finished actions, okay? That's a very important distinction. It is like, for example, again, if you say, I didn't go to France, that is the simple past. When you say, I didn't go to France, that means there was 1 chance and I didn't do it, and it's finished. It's never going to change. Maybe last semester, your group had a trip to France, and maybe this last semester, all your friends went to France and you didn't go. If you say, I didn't go to France, it means I didn't go. I mean, there was 1 chance and I blew it. I didn't go. It's going to be like that forever. Normally, people don't say, I didn't go to France. Again, I didn't go to France, you're speaking about 1 specific time. Normally, people say, I haven't gone to France. When you say, I haven't gone to France, what you mean is that you haven't had the experience. I have never gone to France, it means I don't have that experience, but maybe tomorrow, or maybe next year, or maybe in 5 years. Right now, I haven't gone, I am not planning on going, I don't really have the money or the time, but maybe next year, maybe in 5 years, maybe in 10 years. Yeah. You normally say, I haven't gone to France, because even if it is not in your plans, you are not thinking that it's forever. If you say, I didn't go to France, it means you're referring to the 1 time, or maybe you are about to die. You're in the hospital and the doctor tells you you're going to die soon. And then you say, I didn't go to France, because it's a finished action, it's a conclusion. That's the way it was, okay? So, how and when to use the present perfect? Let's check this part. The present perfect, again, as you remember, for affirmative statements, I'm going to write right here. Well, right here. For affirmative statements, what do you need? You need, this is an affirmative statement. So you need a subject, then you need your auxiliary, then you need your verb, and then you need your complement. Remember that the complement is always optional. If you don't want to use a complement, don't use a complement. That is always okay. So if you are making a sentence in the simple past, sorry, in the present perfect, what do you need? Subject again is the doer of the action. What is the auxiliary? What is the auxiliary of the past, of the present perfect? In the present perfect, the auxiliary is going to be the verb have. But it's not only the verb have. It's the verb have in the present. This is the present perfect. So in the present, the verb have has two possibilities. It can be have or it can be has. Again, you need to remember the rules that we have in the simple present, yeah? When you have the first person of the singular, I, then you use have. The second person of the singular, you, have. The third person of the singular, this is the difficult one. She, he, or it, has. In the plural, you have we, have, you have, and they have. Okay, so this is what you get. Have, has, have, and have. When do you use has? When you have the third person of the singular. He, she, or it has, okay? What other rules do we have? Another very important rule is that the verb is always in the past participle. This verb is always, always, every single time in the past participle, okay? So you can say, I have gone, I have tried, I have jumped. Remember that the past participle, we were speaking about it a little while ago, a verb in past participle is not, it's a conjugation, it's not a time tense. Present perfect uses the past participle, it's not past, it's just the name of the, it's just the name of the conjugation. A verb in past participle is very simple, because when you have regular verbs, if you have a regular verbs is just the verb plus the or ed. For example, when you have jump, the past participle is jump. When you have walk, the past participle is walked. Walked. If you have, think about one more. Cook. The past participle is, cooked. Yeah? It's very simple when you have regular verbs. The problem is that we have a lot of irregular verbs. These are the ones that we have to check. We have to learn them. On the description of the video, I will leave you a list of verbs in the past participle. There are maybe 20 or 30 that you just have to memorize. You have to memorize them, okay? So there's another problem. So right now, let's just finish this. Again, I have, You have, he, she, it, has, we, you, and they have. Another important thing with this is that when you are using have as an auxiliary, you can use contraction. Instead of I have, you can say I've. Instead of you have, you can say you've. Instead of he has, his, she has, she's, it has, it's. Instead of we have, you can say we've. Instead of you have, you've. Instead of they have, they've. Okay? The verb on the sentence is always in the past participle. Okay? That's very good. That's very, very nice. Now, then we have another problem here. The problem that we have is that it might be a little confusing when you have these contractions, the contraction his, she's, or it's. It can be a little difficult because you don't really know what they mean. His can mean two different things. It can mean he has, like in the present perfect, or he is, like in the simple present. Again, when you have the auxiliary, well, the contraction she's or it's, they can have multiple meanings. Maybe it means she has or it has in the present perfect, or maybe it means she is or it is. So you don't really know if his is he has or he is. You don't really know if she's is she has or she is. You don't really know if it's is it has or it is. How can you tell the difference? How do you tell the difference? By looking at the, at the context. You need to check the order of the words, okay? You need to check the grammar. So remember, again, you need to have subject, auxiliary, verb, and sometimes complement. Remember, in the simple present and in the simple past, the auxiliary is not really used, okay? So what is the meaning of this? Let me just move it a little bit. What is the meaning of this? Okay, so you have, again, subject, yeah? Then you have the apostrophe S. And you don't know if this apostrophe S is the auxiliary has or the verb to be. So you have, let's check, your auxiliary is, your auxiliary is or has, your auxiliary is or has. What do you need next? If you have the present perfect, you need subject, auxiliary, has, and then a verb in the past participle. In this case, eating is not a verb in the past participle. It's a verb with ing. What is the meaning of this? The meaning of this is that this sentence is actually in the present continuous. Subject, auxiliary, verb, and complement. Yes? It means that you have your subject, you have your auxiliary, you have your verb with ing, and you have your complement. If your auxiliary is the verb to be, and your verb is with ing, this is the present continuous. So this is happening right now. He's eating cereal. In this moment, he is eating cereal. This his is he is. This is the one. Does it make sense? Yeah? Okay. The next one. You have, it says, you need subject, auxiliary, verb. Wait a second. This is not a verb. From Spain is not a verb. This is a place. This is a noun, and this is a preposition. So this is not the verb. If this is not the verb, what is the verb? If this is not the verb, it means that the verb is here. This is the verb. So you don't have an auxiliary. Why don't you have an auxiliary? Because it is the simple present. In the simple present, you have subject, your verb, the verb to be, he is, and then at the end, you have your complement. Your complement is the extra thing. Like cereal in this case, it was the complement. From Spain, it is the complement. So what is the meaning of that? This sentence, he is from Spain. Yes? You have your subject. You don't have an auxiliary because this is the simple present and this is the verb to be. So you never use the auxiliary here. This one is the verb and this is the complement. So his means he is. Is it okay? The final one. You have your subject. You have your auxiliary, and then you have a verb in the past participle, and you have a complement. What is the meaning of that? If you have a verb in the past participle, if you have the auxiliary has, he has, and a verb in the past participle, it means that this sentence is in the present perfect. Does it make sense? Okay. You have again, subject, auxiliary, a verb in the past participle, and a complement. If you have the auxiliary have or has, and the verb in the past participle, this is the present perfect. If you have the auxiliary is or am or are, and the verb in ing, this is the present continuous. So you have to understand the difference, okay? So I will explain in Spanish this part because it is really, really important. Okay, el presente perfecto, ya sabemos que se puede utilizar para hablar de una, estamos hablando de experiencias, estamos hablando de acciones no terminadas, y estamos hablando de cosas que hiciste en el pasado, pero no importa cuántas veces, yo he hecho, yo he ido, yo he estado, ¿ok? Ahora, el problema es, el auxiliar del presente perfecto, ¿cuál es? Have o has. Have para la primera y la segunda persona del singular y para todos los plurales. Has solo es para la tercera persona del singular. Como está en presente, pues la tercera persona del singular lleva ese. Entonces el auxiliar es has. Y el verbo, por obligación, siempre, siempre, siempre va en pasado participio. ¿Ok? Pasado participio. Recuerden que el pasado participio es una conjugación. ¿Sí? Los pasados participios normalmente son iguales que el pasado simple. Es muy sencillo. Nada más tenemos el verbo con ed. El problema son los irregulares no los vamos a tener que aprender. Y abajo en la descripción del video les voy a dejar una tabla con verbos irregulares para que ustedes puedan irlos checando. Y mientras más los usen, más se los van a ir aprendiendo, pero eso pues, no hay manera de darles vuelta. ¿Okay? Ahora, la parte que les está explicando aquí, que es un poco complicada, es que cuando tenemos nosotros his, she's or it's, es un poco difícil porque no sabemos si his significa he has o he is. No sabemos si she's significa she has or she is. It's, no sabemos si significa it has or it is. Puede ser he must has o he must is. ¿Cómo sabemos eso? Pues bueno, buscando nuestra estructura. Recuerden que la estructura es lo más importante. Nuestras palabras... El idioma no está hecho de palabras, el idioma está hecho gracias a la estructura. Y esa es la estructura, sujeto, auxiliar, verbo y complemento. ¿Ok? ¿Se acuerdan de esta parte? Entonces yo voy a ver, por ejemplo, he's eating cereal. ¿Cómo sé si esta S es has o es is? Bueno, tengo mi sujeto, tengo mi auxiliar y tengo mi verbo. Mi verbo está en ing. Si mi verbo está en ing, eso quiere decir que mi auxiliar es el verbo to be. Cuando tu auxiliar es el verbo to be en presente y el verbo está en ing, este es el presente continuo. He is eating cereal. ¿Qué significa eso? Él está comiendo cereal. ¿Cuándo? Justo en este momento. El presente continuo significa en este momento. ¿Sí? Porque este verbo está en ing, sabemos que este auxiliar es el verbo to be. Entonces, ya supimos. Acá, por ejemplo, tenemos sujeto, auxiliar y ya después no hay verbo. No podemos tener sujeto y auxiliar sin verbo. Eso quiere decir que esta S de aquí no es el auxiliar, sino que es el verbo en sí mismo. Lo que no tenemos es auxiliar. El auxiliar es normalmente para el presente simple es do or does, pero nunca se usa ni en oraciones afirmativas en presente simple y menos con el verbo to be. Si no se acuerdan de eso, vayan al video sobre el presente simple, hablamos de esto. Entonces, ¿qué significa esta S? Esta S es el verbo. Aquí lo que dice es he is from Spain. El verbo es esta S de aquí. He is from Spain. Si no tengo auxiliar, quiere decir que lo que está aquí es el verbo. Entonces, este his significa he is. En este último, tenemos sujeto, auxiliar, verbo y complemento. ¿Cómo está el verbo? Acá el verbo estaba en ing. Eso quiere decir que el auxiliar era el verbo to be. Aquí el verbo está en participio. Eso quiere decir que el auxiliar está en presente perfecto. El auxiliar de he, en presente perfecto, lo tenemos aquí, es he has. O, todo junto, his. Este his significa he has. Tenemos sujeto, nuestro auxiliar es el verbo have, en tercera persona, has, y el verbo siempre está en participio. Por lo tanto, esta es una oración en presente perfecto. ¿Ok? Finalmente, quiero recordarles también que, bueno, aquí tenemos otra oración con nuestro sujeto, nuestro auxiliar, que siempre es have o has, como es la primera persona, I have. Este es un adverbio, have never, ever. Recuerden que los adverbios pueden ir en varios lugares de la oración. Entonces aquí es como si fuera una oración negativa, pero en realidad este adverbio puede ir, puede moverse. Entonces no lo vamos a contar en la estructura. Sujeto, auxiliar, verbo. El verbo está en pasado participio. ¿Se dan cuenta cuál verbo es este? El verbo been. Es el verbo to be en pasado participio. Otra vez, en el presente perfecto, el verbo to be es un verbo como cualquier otro. ¿Cómo le hacemos con el verbo go? En pasado participio, gone. ¿Cómo le hacemos con el verbo jump? En pasado participio, I have never jumped. ¿Cómo le hacemos con el verbo walk? En pasado participio, I have never walked. ¿Cómo le hacemos con el verbo to be? Como cualquier otro verbo. El verbo to be en pasado participio, I have never been. ¿Ok? Es el verbo be, en participio been, y después tenemos nuestro complemento. Sujeto, auxiliar, verbo y complemento. No sobre esta palabra porque es un adverbio, y recuerden que los adverbios tienen varios lugares en donde pueden quedar. Por eso empezamos por ver las palabras y después estamos viendo los tiempos. Espero que esto les haya sido de utilidad. Es un poco complicado, son muchas, muchas cositas. Pero bueno, ya vimos el presente simple, el presente continuo, el presente perfecto. No es cierto, perdón. Vimos el presente simple, el pasado simple y el futuro simple. Vimos el presente continuo, el pasado continuo y el futuro continuo. Y ahorita vimos el presente perfecto. Nos falta ver el pasado perfecto y el futuro perfecto. Y después otros tres de los que vamos a hablar un poco más adelante. De los 12 tiempos que les dije que había, este es el séptimo. Nos falta ver 5 más. ¿Ok? Si tienen alguna duda, alguna pregunta, por favor, traten de escribir esto en su, ¿cómo se llama? En una libreta, sus dudas, traten de escribirlas en una libreta. Y si tenemos oportunidad, pues tratamos de checar todo esto durante el durante las sesiones que tengamos ya realmente, ¿sí? Ahora, perdón, nos falta un pedacito todavía, ¿sí? ¿Se acuerdan que tenemos? We have, I'm going to go back to English. We have 4 different types of sentences. We have statements. Well, maybe not with black because it is a little hard to see. So we have statements and we have questions. We have 2 types of statements. We have affirmative statements and negative statements. We have yes, no questions and we have information questions. You remember that because of that, we have 4 different variations of the structure. For affirmative statements, subject, auxiliary, verb, and complement. You have eaten pizza. Subject, auxiliary have, verb in the past participle, eaten, and pizza. You have eaten pizza, okay? You remember that if you wanna make them negative, the auxiliary takes the negative. Subject, auxiliary with negative, verb, and complement. Subject, auxiliary with negative, verb and complement. You haven't eaten pizza. The have is the one that takes the negative, okay? You also remember that when you want to make questions, you need to invert the order. It's not subject auxiliary, it's auxiliary subject. So auxiliary subject, verb, and complement. We have them here. Auxiliary subject, verb, and complement. Have I eaten pizza? Because the subject is I, the auxiliary is have. And then finally, we have information questions. Information questions are the same as yes, no question. Auxiliary subject, verb, and complement. Auxiliary subject, verb, and complement. The only difference is that you start with a question word. So you start with a question word. Why, where, when, how, depending on the question word is the information that they are going to give you. When you ask why, they are going to give you the reason. So why has he eaten pizza? Question word, auxiliary, subject, verb, and complement. Why the auxiliary has? Because the subject is he, is the third person of the singular. Why has he eaten pizza? He has eaten pizza because, and I give you the reason, okay? Before we finish, I wanna make a little point. I wanted to speak about something because it can be a little confusing. How do you make these sentences in negative? We have two sentences. We have the sentence, I have a new car, and the sentence, I have eaten sushi. How do you make them negative? I will block this for a second so that you have to think about it for a moment. Let's make them negative. I have eaten sushi. Subject, I, negative, subject. The auxiliary takes the negative. Haven't eaten sushi. I haven't eaten sushi. Perfect. What about this? I haven't, verb in the past participle. Oh, that is a problem. Because this here is not a verb in the past participle. If this is not a verb in the past participle, then this is the verb. So when have is the verb, have cannot take the negative. Who takes the negative? The auxiliary takes the negative. If have is the verb, have is not the auxiliary. What is the auxiliary? Remember, this is the simple present. In the simple present, the auxiliary is do or does, but you never use it. If you don't use the auxiliary, then the verb is have, and the complement is a new car. So what is the mistake? Well, the mistake is that you cannot say haven't, because haven't is when have is the auxiliary and it takes the negative. Haven't, the auxiliary takes the negative. In this case, the auxiliary is do and the auxiliary takes the negative, okay? So the auxiliary is taking the negative and then we need the verb. The verb is have, and then a new car, the complement. A new car. So, I don't have a new car, I haven't eaten sushi. Don't es el auxiliar, no estaba en afirmativo no lo tenemos aquí en ningún lado. ¿Sí? Por eso nos costó trabajo y quisimos poner haven't. Dijimos, I haven't, pero no, porque have es el verbo. No el auxiliar. El que se lleva el negativo es el auxiliar. Si no lo tenemos en afirmativo, en negativo lo ponemos. Entonces, no hay que confundirnos, porque la palabra have, aquí tenemos esta misma palabra have y have, pero en este caso está en verde porque está haciendo la función de ser el auxiliar y el verbo está en pasado participio. Aquí está en azul porque en realidad es el verbo, ¿sí? El auxiliar en realidad tendría que estar en verde y tendría que ser do, pero no se usa en afirmativo, ¿sí? Si lo quiero hacer en negativo, entonces sí necesito mi auxiliar para que se lleve el negativo. I don't. ¿Más o menos? Espero que esto les ayude mucho. Otra vez, I have been alone, yo he estado solo. Sujeto, auxiliar, verbo en pasado participio y complemento. Si el verbo en pasado participio es el verbo to be, no importa. El verbo to be es como cualquier otro verbo. Eaten, had, gone, o been. Es un verbo en pasado participio. Sin ningún problema. Siempre, siempre es lo mismo. ¿Ok? Esto sería el pasado perfecto. Pero antes de terminar, les quiero recordar nada más un par de adverbios. Un par de adverbios que son muy, muy, muy comunes en los tiempos perfectos. Los adverbios yet, already, y still. A lo mejor los han visto, creo que son parte de tercero o de cuarto semestre, estoy casi seguro de que ya los vieron, pero se los voy a volver a mencionar porque esos son adverbios que son muy comunes en los tiempos perfectos. ¿Cómo se usan? Acuérdense que los adverbios no tienen un lugar específico, se pueden poner aquí, acá, acá, en cualquier lado. Pero en realidad estos adverbios suelen tener un lugar específico. ¿Cómo se usan? Bueno, muy sencillo. Yet y still sirven con oraciones negativas. ¿Sí? Negativas o preguntas. Yet still with negative statements or questions. ¿Y para qué sirven? Lo que están haciendo es que el negativo sea más negativo. Están haciendo énfasis en la negatividad. Que la pregunta sea más enfática también. Already se usa con oraciones afirmativas. ¿Y qué hace? Que la oración afirmativa sea todavía más afirmativa. Si dices, you have eaten pizza, ok, tú has comido pizza, es una oración afirmativa. Pero si dices, you have already, perdón, quedó un poco separado, already eaten pizza, entonces estás haciendo que esta oración sea extra afirmativa. Estás ratificando que es afirmativa. You have already eaten pizza. Tú ya has comido pizza. ¿Sí? Ya era afirmativa, ahora la haces extra afirmativa. La palabra already es un adverbio, entonces suele ir aquí entre el auxiliar y el verbo. Pero también puedes decir, you have eaten pizza already. Los adverbios no tienen un lugar específico, entonces puede ir aquí o puede ir acá. O puedes decir, you already have eaten pizza. Los adverbios no tienen un lugar específico. Normalmente podrían ir aquí, podrían ir aquí o podrían ir acá. Especialmente el adverbio already. ¿Qué pasa con el adverbio yet? El adverbio yet se usa en negativos. Esta es una oración negativa. You haven't eaten pizza. Se puede hacer extra negativa. ¿Cómo la hacemos extra negativa? Con el adverbio yet. ¿Sí? Pero yet siempre suele ir al final. You haven't eaten pizza yet. Tú no has comido pizza aún o todavía. No la has comido y estoy haciendo extra negativa esta oración. No has comido pizza, todavía no has comido pizza. ¿Sí? Yet, eso sí, suele ser un adverbio que va hasta el final. Incluso también se puede usar en preguntas. Have I eaten pizza? ¿Ya he comido pizza? O puedes decir, have I eaten pizza yet? ¿He comido pizza ya? La respuesta es no lo has hecho, o sí, igual ya lo has hecho. ¿Ok? ¿Y cuándo se usa el still? Bueno, estos dos son iguales. Los dos hacen que el negativo sea extra negativo o que la pregunta sea una extra pregunta. Pero solo usamos uno o el otro. Si yo voy a usar still, entonces no uso yet. ¿Dónde uso still? Still no suele ir al final. Still suele ir aquí, entre el auxiliar y el verbo. You haven't still eaten pizza, o acá. You still haven't eaten pizza. Este still está haciendo que el negativo sea extra negativo. ¿Sí? Otra vez, pueden usar yet o pueden usar still. Hacen que las oraciones negativas sean más enfáticamente negativas. Pueden usar already, pero already hace que las oraciones afirmativas sean más enfáticamente negativas. Así es como funcionan. ¿Sí? Ahora, hay otro par de adverbios que también quiero que hablemos antes de terminar, porque también son muy comunes y creo que también los vieron como parte del programa. Estamos hablando de for y since. Estos adverbios son muy comunes en los tiempos perfectos. Se usan para hablar de tiempo. Podemos usar for o podemos usar since. Después de aquí vamos a decir tiempo. ¿Cuál es la diferencia? Cuando usan for, van a hablar de un periodo de tiempo. You haven't eaten pizza. You have eaten pizza for months. Has estado comiendo pizza por meses. Llevas meses comiendo pizza. Meses es un periodo de tiempo. Por meses, por años, por días, por semanas, por horas. Vas a decir un periodo de tiempo. Cuando usas since, no se pronuncia science, se pronuncia since. Science es science, ciencia. Since, no vas a poner un periodo de tiempo, no vas a poner meses. Vas a decir un punto específico en el tiempo. Vas a decir ayer, antier, el 8 de octubre, el 6 de diciembre. Vas a decir a point in time. You haven't eaten pizza since August. Since August the 6th. No has comido pizza desde el 6 de agosto. Este es un periodo de tiempo, ¿sí? Una cosa que no podemos hacer es poner aquí una fecha. No podemos decir, por ejemplo, un punto en el tiempo. No podemos decir, you have eaten pizza for yesterday. ¿Sí? Esto no se puede. Esto está imposible. No podemos usar un punto. Aquí tampoco podemos usar, since y después un periodo de tiempo. Since 6 months. No puedes decir desde 6 meses. Lo que sí se puede hacer es que cuando usas since, puedes poner un periodo de tiempo y después poner ago. 6 months ago. Aquí dice, tú no has comido pizza desde hace 6 meses. Hace 6 meses es un periodo en el tiempo. 6 meses es un periodo de tiempo. ¿Sí? Perdón. Hace 6 meses es un punto en el tiempo. Hace 6 meses. Y 6 meses solos, entonces sería un periodo de tiempo. For 6 months. O since 6 months ago. ¿Ok? Estos son los que teníamos que haber visto. Creo que estos los dije ahorita bastante rápido porque no quiero alargar demasiado la clase y esto es algo que se supone que ya vimos. Entonces, bueno, recuerden cómo se usa for, cómo se usa since, cómo se usa yet, cómo se usa still, cómo se usa already. Estos 5 adverbios son muy, 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 muy comunes en los tiempos perfectos. ¿Ok? Cualquier duda, por favor, apúntenla. Y me lo pueden decir ya sea en los comentarios, en el grupo que tenemos de WhatsApp o cuando tengamos una sesión interactiva en Zoom. También podemos checar todos los ejercicios que ustedes tengan. Yo les voy a dejar tarea que tiene que ver con esto. Estamos al pendiente entonces y bueno, cuídense mucho. See you. Bye.